Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to our Tech Talk. Before starting our Tech Talk, we would kindly ask the audience to keep their microphone and videos mute during the presentation. And we would like to remind you that at the end of the presentation, we would have the round of questions. So this afternoon, we have as a guest, Dr. Venera Weinhardt. She is originally from Tomsk, Russia, where she did her undergraduate studies in physics at the Tomsk Polytechnic University, followed by master focus on X-ray phase contrast imaging. And afterwards, she moved to Germany and concluded her PhD at the Karlsruhe Institute of Technology, focused on 3D imaging based on hard X-ray grating interferometry. And since 2019, she works as researcher scientist at the Center for Organismal Studies at the University of Heidelberg. So this afternoon, Venera will present us the topic correlated light and soft X-ray microscopy of single cells. So once more, thanks for joining to our Tech Talk, Venera, and the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. I wish I would be able to be in person, visit the town and the university. I have never been in Tübingen, actually. I have used some time to just browse through the website of a center, and I think I'm going to have a perspective on the same questions in terms of cell biology, but a bit from the different angle and from the angle of the structure and analysis of single cells in terms of a 3D anatomy. And I think what sometimes we forget that cell biology is intricately connected with the development of the imaging methods. More than 200 years ago, the whole concept of a cell became open to us and available due to development of a first light microscope. And through this, maybe a bit sparse imaging here, you can see on the left, one could imagine, or at least for some hundred years we thought, that the cell is just simply a bag of enzymes or eating enzymes like this Pokemon just walking around, and this is all very simple. Now, nowadays, we know that the cell is very complex structure, and one would or could compare to one large city, where on one side there are many dynamical processes happening at the same time, and then on our side they happen within a 3D structure, which is also very complex and has different levels. Understanding the importance of structure of a single cell and how much does it tell us about the health of the humans and the diagnosis, monitoring, and even treatment of a disease, a number of consortia has emerged in the last years, which focus actually on mapping those single cells and their variability in our human body. All these consortia would be based on the spectrum of different characterization techniques, among them genome mapping, transcriptomics, of course, and metabolomics, but also structural methods like imaging techniques. If you will have a look through the available imaging methods for single cell analysis, you will see here about three different types. On one side, there are light microscopy techniques, particularly fluorescent microscopy techniques with a resolution of 200 nanometers, which we use, I would say, on the daily basis in the lab, and they are almost ubiquitous nowadays in the research. And then some of you might also know electron tomography or cryo-electron tomography or scanning electron tomography. They would all be a group of methods based on the electron and use of electrons for creating the contrast. And those methods typically provide very high resolution of a few nanometers only. So there is, you can mention between those two groups of methods, there is almost like a natural gap, which is currently occupied by the method which is called soft X-ray tomography. It can provide a spatial resolution starting from around 15 nanometers to 60 or 70 nanometers. And it also is applicable for imaging of single cells. So I think since most of us are familiar with light and electron microscopy, so what is soft X-ray tomography? And X-rays, I think sometimes they are, maybe because of the name, it seems to be something mysterious, but actually X-rays has the same nature as light. X-rays as part of a visible light, as visible light are part of electromagnetic radiation, which is shown here as radio, microwave, infrared, and then gamma rays. It just happens that this electromagnetic radiation spreads over a very long range of photon energy and the wavelength. And so you can see here that the visible light actually occupies a very thin stripe on this very broad range. And the X-rays here are occupying very large range of energies. And it just happened traditionally that we physicists like to separate this large energy range to soft and hard X-rays based basically on the energy. But what is the most important, because they have the same nature, the same physical rules apply, meaning that the spatial resolution as for the light, as for X-ray microscope, would depend on the wavelength and numerical aperture. And it just happens such that the wavelength of X-rays is much shorter, as you can see here, in comparison to the visible light. So it can provide per se better spatial resolution. On another side, the contrast and penetration depth of X-rays as from visible light depends on the refractive index N. Now, for most of the materials, light visible light interacts very strongly with the matter, while X-rays do not. And so they can penetrate very large objects. If you think about the X-rays, I think the most common examples which comes to us is the scans as here shown on the left upper corner, which we always have undergoing airport security where our luggage is scanned with X-rays. It can shoot through a complete suitcase and one can see all the content inside. But also what we know in the medical field is a medical computed tomography. It's also based on the X-rays or hard X-rays, which can penetrate the complete body. I think statistically speaking, every second citizen in the US has have done CT scan at least once in their life. I mean, it can be from the simple scan of the dental scan going down to the bones or mammography scans. But more and more X-rays start to be applied in also fundamental science on the science on the smaller scale. And one example is a cultural heritage where what is seemingly is a pack stone where we don't see the specimen inside, we can create a virtual sectioning and reconstruct in the end the anatomy of the sample inside. In this case, it's parasitic wars. And most of the natural history museums nowadays have X-ray micro CT scanner, which allows basically to create on one side a digital collection of a specimen, and then on another side to actually use the as a model to print then the specimens, sometimes even enlarged because the insect in the small in the fossilized insect can be very small for the exhibitions. And then also on top of that, on top of this cultural heritage, X-ray starts to be also used in developmental biology. Here's an example of in vivo imaging performed with the X-rays where we could track single cells inside of developing frog embryo. And because X-rays can penetrate so far, they can see the whole embryo at once. Now, I'm not going to talk here at both at this macrometer scale objects. I'm going today to focus only on single cells and the technique which is designed to image only single cells, so soft X-ray microscopy. So the X-ray microscope, because of the same nature, is eventually a light microscope. There is nothing, there is no magic here. There is a source which provides X-rays. It's typically a facility which basically shoots, you don't see anything inside, but there is X-rays coming in the light. And then there would be two lenses. One is a condenser, which is supposed to collimate the light onto the specimen. And then the objective lens, which would then magnify this light onto the camera. So the principle is the same as any light microscope. The theoretical background and the advantages of this X-ray microscopy for single cell analysis were actually laid out already in the 80s, last century. However, the system, the X-ray microscope, did not exist until this century. Why is that so? Because X-rays interact with matter rather weak, so they penetrate further away, they penetrate deeper than the light, then one needs to use different type of objectives. So one cannot just put a piece of glass to focus the X-rays. That would not be sufficient to bend the rays. For that, they're using so-called diffractive elements. And what does it mean? That one needs to create a structure which has periodic with the period equivalent to the wavelength of X-rays. And as you mentioned before, it's very short. It's on the range of 30 nanometers. So the structures has to be of the size of 30 nanometers. And then they have to cover complete beam. So they have to be also very large, as you can see here on the left. And this technology to create such nanostructures of a large area of field of view were not existing until development of electron lithography. So our days was lenses are actually written with the electron writer, where electrons are shooting and basically create all this diffraction pattern. So because of the development of these lenses, the soft X-ray microscope, which are applicable for single cell imaging, actually started their life basically in 2000 and later on. Something very particular about X-ray microscope designed for single cell analysis, they don't only use soft X-rays, but they use so-called water window. So we will plot the energy of the photons here on the X scale versus so-called linear attenuation coefficient or X-ray absorption, or in analogy to light, one can also call it optical density. One would see a typical profile of a carbon, which is in orange, and it has so-called absorption edge at this particular energy here. So it means that the carbon atom would absorb at this energy of the photons, very like a lot of photons in comparison to the photons with the energy lower, for example, at 200 electron volts. So this is called an absorption edge. And in this water window, carbon and the nitrogen has absorption edges, while water, which is pointed here in blue, does not have. It is transparent, meaning if the X-rays go through the wet organic tissue, one would see a carbon or the proteins inside, but not the water. That creates an ideal environment to look at cells in their natural wet conditions in the cell culture and basically retrieve something like that. So you see on the right, a human a slice through the human lymphoblastoid cell. This is a cell and you can see nothing around it because the cell culture or the cell media around is transparent and the contrast is created by the protein inside the cells. Because of this natural contrast of soft X-ray tomography, the interesting thing of the sample preparation can be summed up as just freeze. So we have cells from the model organisms or from just petri dishes. Typically we just pellet them and then we load with a microloader in the thin wall glass capillary. It's the same as one pulls for injection into the model organisms. And this needle effectively is just rapidly plunged inside the liquid propane. And the specimen is frozen there inside the cells, all of which are inside the capillary. That's it. There is nothing else needed. There is no need for fixation. There is no need for labeling. The contrast comes natural. So there is no actually need to do anything with the cell. So the soft X-ray microscope insofar, I mean, it's a big machine. Relatively, it's hard to show it here. But there is a specimen with a capillary where the cells are positioned inside. And this specimen is positioned between the condenser, which would collimate the light on this specimen. And then the downstream where would be an objective or MZP, how we call it, which would then magnify the image onto the camera. And because the specimen is frozen, they have a flow of helium gauss. So it's actually positioned in the air and everything what happens, the cold helium gas at a temperature of minus 180 degrees Celsius just flowing up while the specimen is rotated for tomographic acquisition such that the specimen is always cold. The whole pipeline would be putting a capillary into the beam, rotating it, and at every rotation angle similar to the medical CT scan acquiring a projection image. You can see here, this is an outline of a cell. I have to say without a trained eye, it's very difficult to see any structures inside, but these projections are then reconstructed in a 3D volume, as you can see here on the right. This is one field of view, something where one can image very nicely a single cell. One can then we shift the capillary vertically and acquire the tomograms at each different position such that the whole number of cells is acquired. And then this data set can be segmented to obtain a 3D anatomy of cells. The whole cell sample preparation takes about 2 to 3 hours. That sounds a lot. Mainly this time is spent for cooling down the system, actually from room temperature to minus 180 degrees. Nowadays, they have a freezing robot, which actually is able to freeze down 60 of those capillaries automatically. So it speeds up quite a bit our sample preparation. Then the imaging for this, for one field of view, so for one three-dimensional tomograph with all projections, it takes only 5 minutes. And we optimized our reconstruction such that they also take 5 minutes per tomogram, meaning after scanning one cell, one can start the next one. And while the second one is imaged, one already looks at the volume of the first one. That helps also to evaluate, basically, is everything okay? Is the sample worth of looking at it, and et cetera, and so on. And in one of our last projects, we image more than 80 cells for each of 10 different conditions. So it allows to actually look at the structural variability of cells in statistically significant sample size. And what is also peculiar of this quantitative X-ray absorption contrast that by now, by looking at so many cells, we already quantify to the X-ray absorption values for all different, for main known different organelles, like lipid droplets. We know that they're very absorbing and the cytoplasm is not. We can differentiate heterochromatin versus euchromatin, which I'll come in a bit. Mitochondria, Golgi apparatus, and endoplasmic reticulum, such that from the 3D reconstruction to the segmentation, we can actually use those absolute numbers in X-ray absorption to segment this cell. So it will be now going just, these are the virtual slices from this one single cell acquired with soft X-ray microscope. And then based on this X-ray absorption coefficients, we can segment with high reliability, three-dimensional anatomy. This particular cell has a lot of endoplasmic reticulum. Not every cell has something like that, but it will go off right now. And you can see this is a 3D view of this particular cell. And I will stop it here. That's unfortunate, but I can do something like that. And so you can see here, this is a structure of Golgi apparatus in 3D. There is one lipid, there is mitochondria, heterochromatin, and euchromatin. We also last year upgraded our microscope to 2 switchable objectives. Up to now, it was always one. We have right now resolution of we had always resolution of 60 nanometers, but right now we also added 35 nanometers on plate. They say they stand to each other side by side, such that as similar to the light microscope, we can basically swap there and back. Depending on the cell type, we are looking at our resolution or first acquire with the 60 nanometers large field of view and then go to 35 nanometers and look at the region of interest. High resolution zone plate or high resolution imaging, of course, is very helpful for the bacteria and yeast and provides much finer details. And then with even having higher resolution in both two examples, we can see, for example, that in mitochondria, even in individual cristae, we can see in the lysosomes, the structure here in one of the human B cells, which is a smaller cell, so we could also image it with 35 nanometers. Now I will just give two more examples before going to the correlation with the fluorescence microscopy. I was talking about the fact that X-ray absorption is a quantitative measure to segment the anatomy of single cells. It can also be used to actually understand something about the nuclei and the DNA packing. So if you look only at the gray values or X-ray absorption in the nuclei, we will see that it's typically have this double peak position in terms of X-ray absorption, where the first peak more absorbing would be for heterochromatin and the lighter or less absorbing would be for euchromatin. Please compare it to the X-ray absorption from for the chromatin of the sperm, which is absolutely densely packed and nothing or not a lot of regions are accessible for readout. And so what we did is we looked at the chromatin organization in 3D in mouse olfactory epithelial cells. The cells were dissected from the tissue, prepared as a single cell suspension, frozen, then imaged, and then also correlated to the fluorescence in situ hybridization data. And what you can see here on the left, but if we plot X-ray absorption values for different cell types, you can directly see that we can differentiate the cells from stem cells, from the progenitors and from the mature neurons already, just by the shape of this DNA packing, where you can see that the euchromatin is, the DNA is not as packed, and there is a large peak on the left, and it progresses towards packing DNA more and more, where the peak of heterochromatin becomes very high here in the mature neurons. This is not just an absolute information to differentiate three different cell types, but one can also look at the 3D organization of the nuclei in both cells. And what one can mention is that while originally there was a proportion of heterochromatin position at the periphery of the nuclei, more and more it then shifted towards being inside. And what and the rest of the genes and the rest of the chromatin, euchromatin being more accessible on the outside. So going a little bit in the direction more of the current topics in cell biology, we know that not all organelles which were presented previously are actually membrane-bound organelles. There are a lot of organelles described in single cells which are going going through the phase transition of within the cytoplasm. Nucleolus is one of it. We know that we can see it. Sometimes we see our organelles in the cytoplasm, we don't know the identity yet. So, but this is one of the topics which interests us, and we would like to know more whether soft X-ray microscopy is actually applicable to first operation. And one of the experiments which we did is, we did in test tubes, not in the single cells. We took RNA bases and phase separated them just in the test tube. All four phase separate. All four guanine looks a bit weird. This is an effect of phase separation. It just creates a large three-dimensional network. And then we first, after looking that they phase separate, we actually can also create something like some subcompartments or substructure, complex 3D architecture by mixing those bases together, particularly those which typically would not mix in the together, like adenine and cytosine. And by varying the proportion of this mixture, we can actually kind of tune the structure of the droplets. What you can see here is the fluorescence microscopy. To image those droplets in the fluorescence microscopy, we spin down those phase separated droplets to create a very large agglomeration. So originally we didn't know whether this is an effect actually of phase separation of us spinning it down and by that kind of mixing it in a very specific order. So what we did is we then imaged it with soft X-ray microscope, and you can see here on the left is a virtual slice through one of those phase separated droplets. And what is very interesting that adenine and cytosine in their chemical composition vary actually in one atom of carbon and two atoms of nitrogen. So they are very close to each other. The oxygen is transparent for us in the microscope, and they are very close in density, but we still can see the difference. As you can see here, there is one very dense droplet inside. And based on this X-ray absorption, we can say that this adenine inside of cytosine and not vice versa. Moreover, we can look also at very small droplets like here, and they are varying from around 200 nanometers in size, and sometimes they go up to multiple micrometers. And those which are wetting the surface of a capillary, this is why they look flat, and these are very small and freestanding. And X-ray tomography, similar to anatomy of a cell, is a quantitative technique. So one can actually analyze the radii of the space droplets, contact angle, and the concentration of the protein inside. So I want to summarize this, that soft X-ray microscopy up to now was successfully applied in many different, on many different cell types, from bacteria, yeast, algae, to primary and immortalized lines. This list as complete as of revision in 2000, a review publication in 2018, which was published. That doesn't include, of course, a recent publication, for example, on pancreatic beta cells in terms of insulin production, done together with Kate White from University of Southern California. Now, if we look back to these different imaging modalities, what is, one can mention is that the soft X-ray tomography together with electron tomography are so-called structural methods. They provide the architecture of cell and they provide it all at once. There is no specificity. In fluorescence light microscopy, we see only the content which we labeled. So the rest of the cell remains for us unknown. However, it's very specific. So we can say, okay, this protein or this specific gene is located here within single cell structure. So it's of course very interesting to combine those two together, for example, soft X-ray tomography and fluorescence microscopy, to visualize this protein of interest within the structure. It seems to be easy, but it's actually quite difficult on multiple levels. One thinks it is sufficient to take, let's say, an X-ray microscope, a fluorescent microscope, and then image the same cells and just put it together. Effectively, these are two different microscopes on one side. On another side, one would like to, or for true correlation, one needs to have it in the same condition. So one doesn't want to remount the specimen, so it has to be also imaged in the capillary in the fluorescent microscope, and also it has to be imaged in the, at the cryogenic conditions. And since there are not so many cryofluorescent microscopes, Markley Gross actually developed years back our own cryogenic fluorescent microscope, which allows us to put the same capillaries, the same frozen cells as imaged by the X-ray microscope to the fluorescent microscope. The difficulty then comes also in data correlation by itself. If we look again at the difference between X-rays and fluorescence and do analogy to the cell being a city, X-rays is the same as doing a photograph of a city during the day. We can see everything. And fluorescence is when we look at the same city at the night. Even though it's different orientations because it's different microscope, I think by eye we can say it here, okay, this is one of the Trade Tower in San Francisco. This is the same tower here. So I think this blue light here has to be here on top. The difficulty also comes, however, with fluorescence per se is much lower resolution than X-rays. So I think you would agree that if we look at such image, it's already, I don't know whether one could correlate them, and particularly not when we would like to do it within the cell at very high resolution. So we do what we do for correlation, we use fiducial markers. We formally, we're putting, these fiducial markers you can see here on red on the surface of a capillary. Recently, we started to do just inside of cell culture media, which allows us to basically find the same orientation under fluorescence imaging as under X-rays. The difficulty comes, however, if one does a conventional fluorescent microscopy, if you ever did it, the through focus scan, those bits are not actually spherical. It's very difficult to determine at the high resolution the exact position, because in that, due to point spot, spread function of a microscope, there is an obvious this elongation. To overcome that, we actually do a fluorescence tomography, meaning we, in the fluorescent microscope, we also rotate the cell and acquire the imaging from different directions. Formerly, it was almost the same acquisition process as with X-rays. Right now, we do only three different directions. And then the so-called reconstruct tomography, fluorescence tomography, and then we can find the position of these fiducial markers very precise. And so what you can see here is an example of this glass capillary, and then the cells here are lined up one after another one. In this case, inside the cells for visibility studies, the lipids are marked. And then the same capillary then go to the soft X-ray tomography, and then the virtual slices are reconstructed. And here the data is already overlaid such that one can say, okay, these are the lipid droplets. This is, of course, that was done for verification that the pipeline works. We also had a look at the free destruction topology of inactive X chromosome in the somatic female mammalian cells, which typically contain two X chromosomes and one of them would be inactive. The inactive X chromosome was labeled via the electroporation with GFP. You can see it here. This is an example of a fluorescent microscopy scan. This is a soft X-ray microscopy data on the same cells, and this is the overlay. And so now we can use this fluorescent microscopy data as a mask saying us where the inactive X chromosome is positioned within the nuclei, and basically get its 3D structure via the X-rays, but with the help of a fluorescent microscopy. And then this is just a different rotation of one of the examples. I can say that the image, many of them, they would all look, they would have different shape and surface, but they would have total volume would be remain the same. The most common feature there would be the distribution of the chromatin packing, particularly the fact that these interfaces, the inactive chromosome is connected to the nucleus, and the nuclear membrane would be densely packed DNA, and then from the outside would be low on the X-ray absorption or something what is more available. Now, maybe you mentioned previously those structures with inactive chromosome. Actually, I can maybe shift back, but effectively, without fluorescent microscopy, one would not see it, but after seeing it once, one could actually detect it on any our cell afterwards again, just because it has very specific contrast within the nuclei. So a bit maybe also on the quest to our mapping of the organelles which undergo phase transition in single cells, but also mapping things which we obviously we cannot see, it seems. We also had a look at the cellular response to stress in the cells, and here these are the osteoblast cells, and which are transgenically labeled, so they have a red fluorescence protein attached to G3BP1 protein, which is associated with stress granules. And upon the stress induction with arsenicum, we can actually see the aggregation of those stress granules here in the cytoplasm. And what we did is we imaged those cells with the X-rays, to be honest, in the hope of seeing stress granules with soft X-ray tomography. And this is again examples. This is a capillary. One can see a cell here, there is a large bit in between to separate them. There is one cell here. Then there is the fluorescence microscopy image. This is a labeled cell. These are fiducial markers, which we use, and they right now lay inside the capillary. And this is an X-ray tomogram of the same cell. And I think without seeing this large bit close to the cell, it would be very difficult to overlay it, but because we have bits here and there is a bit here and there are ours in the volume, one can actually do it very precise, such that in the end, even though we don't see it with soft X-ray microscopy or stress granules, we can see them via the fluorescent microscopy labeling. You can mention here while it goes through, there is nothing in the cytoplasm at this moment. We, to be honest, don't know the reason for that. the assumption would be that the concentration of the proteins inside is not sufficient for us to basically create this contrast for 3D imaging. Nevertheless, by using both two microscopes together, one can actually reconstruct then the whole cell at once in 3D and see the position of the stress granules acquired with a fluorescent microscopy within the context of the whole cell, mitochondria, lipids, and endoplasmic reticulum, and see that this process is orchestrated such that ER can be found very close in the contact of the stress granules, while the mitochondria actually kind of prevents this, compensate for the stress response by keeping away from the stress granules. So this correlation approach we like a lot. And of course, if we look back again towards spectra of imaging techniques, it would be very nice to combine now with soft X-ray microscopy with super resolution microscope. Again, due to the difficulties, number one, we would like to have it cryogenic, and number two, we need it in 3D. We are faced with the challenge of building it ourselves, which we are doing currently. We are building a structured illumination microscope, cryogenic, with the possibility of doing a 3D imaging, including the rotation of a specimen. This is one of our developments. And then, our future development, which we are currently pursuing, is the development actually of a compact soft X-ray microscope of the size, I don't know, 2-3 typical working tables, which could be potentially brought to any laboratories. The example of the system here is on the right. We currently can achieve a resolution of 60 nanometers. Here on the left, you can see structures of 120 nanometer size. And here at the bottom right, there are first structures or first biological objects which we image in the projection mode. 3D tomography is not yet possible, but we hope it will be possible by the end of the year, including cryogenic imaging or imaging at your cryogenic conditions. And with that, I would like to acknowledge the collaboration partners, National Center for X-ray Tomography, where I did my postdoc, and a lot of data comes from there. And then the Jochen Wittbrod, who actually recommended me for this talk, and I have a first PhD student who just started to work. If you would like to know more about the technique, and for me, it's very difficult to transfer like a feeling how the microscope looks like. There is actually a video created by the television series over the link here. Of course, feel free to contact me anytime, and I hope to be able to answer as many questions as there are. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Venera. It was really an interesting presentation. I think now we could start with our round of questions. There is already one question in our chat. Somebody has the curiosity to know how long can an X-ray time lapses be for single cells?
So time lapse would assume that you image the same cell multiple times. Just to make sure that you don't mean imaging live, I would like to say that the whole imaging is taking place at the cryogenic conditions. So X-rays generally, because of the natural contrast and interaction with matter, would actually deposit a lot of dose on the single cells. So live imaging of single cells with X-rays, at least with soft X-rays, is not possible, and that's why it's not possible yet. I believe that X-ray microscopy one day would be possible of imaging live cells. But so frozen cells up to now, so these two acquisitions with two different objections, objectives we managed up to now to image without seeing the effect of a radiation dose, which in our case would be typically by the deformation of the ice around the cell, so one would see the typical gaps or distortion of a capillary. We are able to image it at least twice in different resolution. whether or not it's possible to do more times would depend on the cell type, its absorption, and of course the spatial resolution which you choose.
We have another question from Sven Nansen.
Okay.
Sven, you can go.
I just speak up. I think it's, I prefer that to write into the. thanks, Venera. Very exciting talk and very exciting images, especially for us since we're mostly looking to sequencing data and more imaging as well. So I really like your approach where you overlaid the X-ray with the fluorescence microscopy, and that really led to functional insights. One question that arose there on my side was, has it ever been tried to overlay single cell omics data with such imaging data? Is that possible at all? Like potentially it's difficult to do technically, and has that been done? Is there some studies around?
So very good question. Or at least very interesting for me personally. No, it hasn't been done. I think, so generally, I would really love to do it. And I think technically it's possible, but it's yet very challenging. So the idea which I have in mind, so we have a capillary with all the cells lined up for imaging, one images then one after another one, and then one keeps the specimen and basically, I don't know, chops one cell after another for a single cell transcriptomics, for example. Up to now, it's not possible because we actually don't keep our specimens. We directly throw them out because that would basically call for us to remove it, still keeping at the cryogenic condition. This is on one side. On another side, we don't know yet how to, separate, and you want to keep the same exact cell, basically, which was just imaged from soft X-rays, to the single cell sequencing. We purchased 1 year ago a very high power laser, and we know we can cut with a laser or glass capillaries and basically chop it to the single cells, but we are still in the development of something like that. I have to admit also, we try to acquire funding for this project, and the last one was not successful. So right now we are not pursuing it as hard as one could, but I hope one day it will come, because I find it always very interesting in those omics approaches to see all these dots of various cells. And then just looking at the structure for me would be fascinating. What physically actually looks different between cells? Is there anything? Like how this connection of transcription, metabolomics works at the single cell level. What does it make? How does it then physically change the phenotype of cells? That's for sure very interesting.
Is there any other question?
I have another one. So it's, I imagine these images are also generating a lot of data. How, and since this, they're small or okay?
Yes. So they actually have a sensor size of 1024 by 1024 pixels. And we don't use, in computer tomography, typically everybody uses filtered back projection, which basically would ask us to acquire 1,500 images. We don't use those reconstruction algorithms. We use our own developed iteration methods, which basically allows us to acquire only 90 images for whole 3D set. So the reconstructions which you saw before for all cells, they were done with only 90 images per cell per 3D volume. And that's a very small amount.
We have a question on our chat. We have one of our colleagues that is wondering how much energy is given to the cells when doing the imaging, because he mentioned that energy and DNA analysis is not great as it leads to base modification, and this similar RNA is not very stable. and processing the cell for multiple minutes will perhaps change the transcriptome signature.
Yes, yes. So I don't know whether the correlation with omics approaches will work. This is something to investigate. I think, unfortunately, I don't have a slide here, but basically we measured the dose which is deposited, and it's in the range of 10 to the power of 5 grays, if I'm not mistaken. I would need to check it. But of course, again, it can be minimized as to going up higher. The effect which X-ray dose would have right now on the, let's say it like the downstream sequencing, I don't know. I can say from my previous projects where I had done X-ray tomography of whole fish, we could genetically sequence it afterwards. And it was imaged for much longer time. But there it would have the same effect. It's very difficult to say, in particular on the single cell level. So one would need just to try, I would say.
We have another question. No, at the moment, no, but I do have a question. So regarding to the applications of this technique. So if there is any interest to push the use of the technique for oncology or for infectious disease, let's say the viral infections, where you could really see the structure and how the interaction goes between the virus and the cells quite close?
Yes, absolutely. So this project, which was just founded last year by European Union, is actually with a focus on virology. Up to now, I have imaged cells and they're affected with herpes virus, baculovirus, and coronavirus. They are just summarizing our manuscript, hopefully to be submitted soon. X-ray, soft X-ray tomography was also done on vaccinia virus and hepatitis C. And within this project, we will look also at hepatitis E additionally to that. In all these cases, we are looking on one side at the remodeling of single cell anatomy by the virus, because they need to basically hijack the machinery of a cell and produce many viruses afterwards. This is on one side. So on the mechanism of that, on mechanism of how from one cell type the virus can be actually attached and propagate in another one, where there is also the differences in this machinery between different cell types. And of course, we also looking whether the drugs and antiviral drugs are acting, let's say it like that, as they suppose. Do they reverse this virus-induced changes at the single cell level, yes or no, and how far they do it? In terms of cancer, so we didn't do so much research as we would like to, I guess. Right now I have a collaboration, I don't know whether I listed, with Andrews Brown from the Barts Cancer Center in UK. And we are looking at the blood cancer cells, particularly with relation to the lamin A. So there is an omics data on the patient showing that there is a strong correlation between the severity of the cancer in terms of lamin A, and we know that it would affect the nuclear structure. So I already did a soft X-ray tomography where one can see in the cells lacking lamin A, the DNA, basically the heterochromatin inside, would open up. And currently we are doing a super resolution microscopy now to correlate these structural changes in heterochromatin with the lamin A position itself. I don't know yet where it would lead, but it's for sure a very interesting direction. And it single cell analysis per se has a lot of applications.
Thanks. I think we have another question. Yeah, and another question is, would you have been affected by the long time plan Trump through the Neuenheimer Feld in Heidelberg?
Sorry, again?
This is just out of curiosity, somebody asked if would you have been affected by the long time plan Trump through the Neuenheimer felt in Heidelberg?
By Trump, you mean Trump from
Straßenbahn.
Straßenbahn. no, I'm sorry. Tram. Okay, sorry. I'm sorry. Because when I hear Trump, I think about US. Sorry.
That's a typo in my message. Sorry for that, Venera. It's out of curiosity because I did my PhD at the Center of Organism Studies also in Heidelberg. Mm-hmm. And there was this huge discussion that there should be a tram going through the Neuenheimer Feld, and we have similar discussions here in Tübingen, and that like medical devices would be heavily affected. And I was just wondering whether that would be the case for your CT scans as well.
So up to now, so the soft X-ray microscopes and all examples which I showed you right now, they are not yet done at the University of Heidelberg. There is a discussion of now of this prototype, which was just created, a laboratory version, which it would come on campus. So there, I cannot say anything. I can say that in Berkeley, up to now, the microscope survived a number of earthquakes, so it's pretty stable. The imaging-wise, actually, it's very interesting because we don't rely so much on the cell being specifically positioned, which a lot of microscopes do. We have a pipeline which afterwards would align all the specimens.
Okay.
So if there are some small vibrations or some shift, which actually happens because our rotation stage is very cheap and unprecise, we don't care about it. Because, and this is an interesting thing, since we put samples in the cylindrical capillary, we can very easily detect those walls and always put the specimen back. And so before every tomographic reconstruction, our sample is automatically aligned. And such that we basically don't feel those vibrations. For laboratory instrument, I don't know yet how we will realize because we're just working on 3D tomography acquisition in general. I know from my time at KIT that every time when the tram is passing, it's two times for the in the morning coming in and two times coming in the afternoon, you can see it on the sensors on all microscopes. You basically just sit and wait 10 minutes until it's gone, and then you can continue to measure. Yeah.
Thanks a lot for you.
We have another question. It's more a comment from one of our colleagues. Mentioned same bivariation sensitivity as the SEMM.
Again, sorry.
Perhaps could he elaborate a little bit more? I think. Not really clear.
Sorry, this is Tony McEnroe from Sirius XT. We're the company who manufactures the lab-based microscope. So the tests that we've done on vibration would indicate that we have the same sensitivity as a, if your room is good enough for an SEM, it's good enough for our microscope. The most sensitive vibrations do tend to be caused by things like trams, because they induce vibrations in the order of 20 to 35 hertz coming through ground. So you actually can measure trams up to about 30 to 50 meters away, but generally it's not a problem. If the room is suitable for a scanning electron microscope, it's suitable for a soft X-ray microscope.
Okay.
Sorry for intruding. I was in stealth.
No, on the contrary. Thanks for clarifying. I did not get the question correctly.
No problem.
Okay.
Very good presentation, Venera. Thank you very much.
Do we have any other question or comment?
Maybe a small question. Now that we're talking about these neat microscopes, have you guys thought about also adding an option to transport your data to a cryo-electron tomography setup? That would be very interesting. But then again, since you're already doing the super resolution, I wonder if that already, whether the use is worth the squeeze, so to say, if you already with the super resolution have it. And as you mentioned, to do these things in the lab are really complex to add more modalities.
Actually, we think, I also think it's very interesting. So we would like to correlate also with electron tomography. Unfortunately, here I don't have resolution. So soft X-ray tomography is unique in the sense that one can see a whole cell at once and reconstruct its general anatomy. What soft X-ray tomography does not provide yet is all these fine details which are possible already with electron tomography. They might be potentially possible with X-ray tomography because the wavelength is much shorter than the 30 nanometers, so the diffraction limit we didn't reach yet. But right now, the electron tomography provides such amount of details and such amount of structures which with soft X-ray tomography we cannot see. I can for sure say you that we cannot see a single coronavirus virions. We are unable to see it. And we would also not detect a number of fine changes in, for example, in endoplasmic reticulum. And so for us, actually, it would be very interesting to correlate it with electron tomography. There were a few comparative studies done, but they were done in the, with the perspective, this is the contrast which one received with electron tomography and resolution. This is a soft X-ray tomography. Look, they show the same kind of. It would be very interesting to correlate. We are planning to do within this European Union project together with University College Dublin. And we also actually tried again to talk about funding for that. Unfortunately, we were not funded, but yeah. So we are looking forward actually to do it. And I think what is also important to keep in mind, these two techniques provide different type of contrast. I mean, electrons, they interact with matter much stronger with X-rays. So even when one looks at the same structure, one sees it with a different contrast. And this, and insofar they would be complementary. And so by performance, kind of like a hierarchical imaging, soft X-ray tomography of single cell, super resolution fluorescent tomography, maybe myelin it with FIB, and then doing electron tomography would be very interesting.
Thank you. Yeah, I agree. That would be really interesting to add this higher resolution, higher spatial resolution. Features that gray electron tomography brings to the table. Yeah.
Okay, do we have any other question or comment for Venera? No, I think though that was, there is one more. No, these are all the questions then and the comments. Thanks a lot, Venera, for the nice presentation and the very interesting topic. And yeah, we will wish you all the best for your research. And we really hope that you can come back in another opportunity to tell us more about the stories that you have just mentioned that you studied and they are on progress. We will really like to hear how were the results.
Thank you so much for having me here. It was very nice discussions. See you again around.
Yeah.
In virtual community, in virtual science community.
In virtual science, exactly.